Let me go around. Is it possible to go, Lyndon? Did I need to go around that way, or can I go this way? Thank you.
Should come around if I. Okay. I'm sure that you met that. You have to be there.
Not that way, sorry. We go around. We go around that way.
Hi, you can check on me. Hey, did I get that? Rocky.
Perfect, Lyndon, well done.
Rocky.
I'm going to ask once.
Yeah.
Once you change to Twitter, I'll ask you
something. Okay, can you make it?
It's saying it's paused.
Yeah.
It's paused here. But I'll let you change the I'm Twitter.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. I'll let you change the
track. Yeah, okay. Okay. Very good.
Yep.
Every break.
Yep.
Everybody. I'd firstly like to welcome you to the BDA conference this morning. My name is Rosemary Orman. I'm one of the trustees on the board of the BDA. I'll be chairing the proceedings today for the conference this morning. It's really lovely to see such a good turnout this morning, so we're very grateful that you've attended. I'm proud to say that this is my birthplace in Manchester. Terry Riley is also the same. I can see a few hands up in the audience. So we're very proud to welcome you all here to Manchester. Unfortunately, Manchester is famous for its weather, and it does rain quite often. I should have maybe said in the pack to bring an umbrella. But today, hopefully, we'll be lucky and it will be fair. In terms of the weather, and I hope you do enjoy the proceedings, but also have a great weekend. There are a few housekeeping items that I need to run through with you this morning. These are the fire escapes that are I'm indicating now, highlighted with a green light above the door. If there is a fire, please leave by those exits. We do have a lot of delegates this morning. We would hope that everything is clear and you can access everything. It will be live streamed this morning. However, if you do have an issue with being videoed, if you inform the gentleman at the back and similarly the photographer, if you don't want to go photographed. We will have two speakers this morning, two keynotes. And then, following the keynote presentations, we'll have a panel session the questions and answers. So if you do have any questions throughout the presentations, if we could ask if you were going to hold off until the Q&A session, we will welcome your questions there. Ashley Kendall will be our first speaker, and he will be presenting on PSCT. Thank you.
I think I'm better off taking my pass off, otherwise it's going to be flapping around everywhere. But good morning. It really is lovely to see so many people in this room. I will make sure I stand here, not in front of my own PowerPoint. But it is lovely to see so many of you. You know, we are celebrating our 124th year of the British Deaf Association today. And we are here to support people all across the age ranges. And simply put, the British Deaf Association is you. That's who we are. We are one community. Now, we know that over the years, the British Deaf Association has had some highs. It's had some lows. We've sometimes lost our way. But one thing for sure is we're always trying to make sure that we are on track. Now, over the last 3 years, the Board of Directors, our Board of Trustees, of which I'm one, we've been talking about the British Deaf Association and the direction that we're taking. Now, we have decided to implement this PCST model. Now, it's really very interesting and something that I very much endorse because it was an idea really created by young people. And as the rep for BDA Youth, that's important to me. Now, we implemented this model as part of the BDA Youth. I brought it forward to the BDA Board of Trustees, and actually we all agreed that this would be a really excellent way to move forward and influence the way that we make our strategies. Now, I've mentioned PCST. What is PCST? Okay, so the P is for political, the S is for social, C, culture, and T, training. So political, social, cultural training. And the idea is that everything that we do, everything that the BDA does, we need to make sure that any ideas in our strategy covers at least one of these elements. So I will go into explaining each one individually now. I'm happy to repeat anything at any point if anyone is unclear. But for PCST, it covers a wide range of things. Now, we are representative of the community. And what's important is if the community approach us and they want us to focus on the political side of things, they'd like to support us in influencing politics, then you're very welcome to do that. If you want to support us with the social aspect of things, like last night, we had the Deal or No Deal at the Manchester Deaf Centre, which was fantastic. We had an auction at the end of the night, and that is an example of us really implementing a social strategy. In terms of culture as well, that's really important, and training. So across the board, it should be a yearly cycle. We start to develop things. Once we feel like we've implemented all of those, we come back full circle, and we start again. So this model we have put here on the PowerPoint, as you can see. Now the idea for the political side of things is to engage individuals to actively campaign for improvement. Now that can be on a national level and that can be on a local level. Now the cultural side of things, we know we have very, very rich history of dramas and things within the deaf community. It would be impossible for me to sum up in one way what the social activities is for the deaf community. We have so many different things for anything relating to the deaf community. And then with training, now this is really important because we should be encouraging deaf people to drive, to develop both themselves but also collectively as a community. And that's why training is crucial for us at the British Deaf Association. So that is, in summary, what we mean by the PCST model. I'll just give you a couple of seconds to look at this slide. Okay, so this slide here shows our model and how we are looking to implement the PSCT. Now, you can see at the top what's really important for us, as we've always maintained, is British Sign Language. It's important that we continue to further British Sign Language. And in terms of gypsum, we've got some people coming into the auditorium, we'll let them come in. Yeah, so I think it was better to have them come in now and have all of your attention. So the idea is to further British Sign Language. Now, how we do that? We do that through a range of different things, politically, socially, culturally, and through training. The idea then is that we can continue to build and grow the community, and we can pass that on to the next generation coming through, and that should always feed in terms of one big cycle. And at the end, we should have the Deaf and BSL community feeding back into the BDA's vision of strengthening British Sign Language. I mean, the idea of any model is that you start it, you maintain it, and when you come to an end, there needs to be a continuation. It has to continuously grow. It needs to continuously develop. Now, I think what's really important to add here is that with the deaf community, sometimes people look at us at the British Deaf Association and they think, well, what are you here for? And sometimes that can be quite a difficult thing to answer, actually, because it's not about delivering services for us, it's about supporting what's there. Now, that could be education. That could be coming to meet people socially. That could be in a pub. I think with this model, with the PCST, the idea is that it continuously grows and develops, and we respond to the needs of the community at any given time. Okay, what's important for us is that the community sees us as being approachable. That's our way forward. Now, this idea will influence our strategy, and hopefully will continue to influence our strategy moving forward. Now, what I don't want to do is go into the minutiae and bore you all and have you fall asleep. So that's pretty much it from me. But if you did have any questions from that session, we'd be more than happy to answer them at the panel.
Okay, thank you, Ashley, for that clear explanation of the model and our new way forward. Obviously, we've got some delegates arriving a little bit later than the start time, so I wonder whether I can just ask people to go up the aisles instead of coming across the front of the room. It's my pleasure to now introduce our next speaker. We have Thomas McQuinney. And he will be representing the BDA Youth Service.
Hello, everybody. I hope you're all fit and well and not too tired. I heard some people had a late night last night. So I'm hoping that you're not too hungover and all able to watch. The theme of my talk today is about navigating the future. And I'm going to focus on how we can navigate the future. But one thing to ask, first of all, is what paths are we talking about? And there are different paths I want to talk about, the different ways that we can navigate. We can walk as a travel, but we need to know where we want to go to know how to get there. We need to have the information before we go on that journey. Now, how do we get the information? Well, first off, people, it's having BSL, which is what we use. And it's important that we have information from BSL. But first of all, I want to tell you about my experience. And then you'll be able to understand where my perspective comes from. Because I need to know where I am now before I know where I want to go to. If I want to go to Australia and I'm already in Australia, then you're already there. So I need to know where I am first of all. First of all, let me tell you about the EDSU. Do all of you know, can anyone put their hands up if they know what the EDSU is? Just a few. Okay. It's the European Deaf Student Union. Now, the EDSU was set up in 2011. Okay, David? Yes? There we are. And this was the first board. Where's me? This is two different people, one from Denmark, one from Spain, one from Bulgaria, the chair is from Belgium, and Sophia as well. And we've also got an Irish representative as well, and I was representing the UK. The EDSU was my first international experience of working together with a group of people. And one of the board created a video, and at the time, it was in international time, and I didn't understand it. But fortunately, there was an English text as well, which I read. And I tried to do my version of international to send it. I sent the when they had their first meeting in Brussels, Belgium, which I went to, and you couldn't understand an awful lot. Do any of you use international sign here? Good. There's a lot of people good. See, in international sign, there are two different levels that are used. There's the social type of international sign, which is very easy. It's very intuitive, a lot of people can use it. And then there's the more officious work international sign, which can be very difficult to understand. Now for me, instead of going into the social international sign first, I went into the more formal, official work international register. And it was very, very difficult. It was lots of new signs that I was having to learn. Now, I'm very, very confident in international sign, but that was a real learning curve. And I'll talk more about international sign later as I go through my speech. Okay, don't do it, let's tell you. But don't get dark in this photograph, but this is in London. We had a meeting in London. And this is Trafalgar Square. This was one of the prints. At this time, the European Deaf Student Union was under the EUDY, the European Union of the Deaf Youth. Basically, they came to have a look at one of our meetings we had, and this was a video of the meeting we had. And this is an island. That's one of the photos of this on the bridge. So that's the EDSU. And to sum up what it is, it's an umbrella organisation that tries to look at setting up regional and national deaf student unions. So far, we do have issues where different students, look, for example, in France, there's issues there with university students, and we try to go in and help to help set up their own organisations. In Bulgaria, again, we're trying to help to set up an organisation there. It's just making sure we've got the critical mass of people to be able to achieve that. Now, there are some where they're already solidly set up. Italy and Germany have really strong student union organisations there. At the moment, the strongest places are Austria, the Netherlands, Denmark, Belgium, and England. So, in England as a region, we haven't got the national. We've got representatives in UCLan and in Wolverhampton as well. Now, I'm personally responsible for Greece and Lithuania. I'm trying to motivate and help them to be able to have the logistics to set up their own student union as well. After this meeting next week, I'll be doing video calls with them to help to set everything up. Now, Do any of you know what this organisation is? UK Deaf Student Union. So this is the UK arm. And really, I'm grateful for the EUD that you were able to set up the student union in the United Kingdom. From looking at the EUD, what was happening on an international platform, I came back to the United Kingdom and thought about what we could do here, and we decided that we needed to set up our own board. Now, three of those are here. There's one there. There's another person. Is she here? I think she's hardly so difficult. I know there's somebody here. So she's now the chair of the group. And the UKSU, the UKDSU. It's quite complicated in a sense because this is the sign. I want to try to sign. It's not an easy sign to do. But if you try that sign, it has an influence of improving things, improving the situation. Basically, I've got some photographs of activities that we've undertaken. This was BSN Pride Day in London. I don't know how many of you were there. You may remember, there was 200, 300 people there on the day. And this is the new board. So the first photograph I showed you was the first board. And this is the recently elected board. James is not in this photo, James Greens, but he's also in the group. So hopefully we'll go from strength to strength. When we set up UKDSU, we wanted to gather as much information as we could about what were the experiences of deaf students in the United Kingdom. Now, in Northern Ireland in 2009, we had a look, there was 300 deaf students in the UK. In 2011, that had dropped precipitously to under 100. Now, we looked at that and we said, what are the reasons for that? And there are many factors. It could be that the level of education they've had and their lack of sign language means that they don't want to be recognised as deaf people, as deaf students. It might be that they're not aware that there is support there and there is a network that we can have. And there's many different factors on why deaf students are declining at university. So UKDSU wants to get as much information as we could. And obviously, we're there to represent deaf students all over the United Kingdom. And we address a whole list of issues, and these issues are still happening at university, they're still happening in the workplace. Unqualified interpreters, or training interpreters, coming in for a lecture, and deaf students are not able to make any sense of them. And when you need someone with an advanced level of language skills, deaf people are left with someone with a limited amount of training, if any at all. But also, deaf students are fragmented throughout the United Kingdom, and isolated as well. And it can, I know from my own experience, it can be very isolating to be one student in a university. Now what UKDSU is there to do is to be able to help with the English arm. We can go to people who could be in Newcastle or Manchester or north of the border in Scotland or Northern Ireland, and we can help them to feel like they're part of a group, and we can help them to network and help them to meet other people and share their experiences and see they're not the only ones who've been through this. Now, let me tell you about the big potentials we have for the deaf student movement. There is a student movement in Europe that is becoming stronger and stronger. And the reason for that is more and more deaf students in Europe, if you look at Eastern Europe and Southern Europe, they're a very poor service. They're coming from a low base, but they're improving a lot. So the movement, we want to help it to gain strength and traction and to grow stronger. The European Union gave a huge budget of 14.7 billion euro. And what this was for the Erasmus Plus project. And Erasmus Plus is a study exchange. So let's say I wanted to do a few years studying in Austria or France or whichever country it is, I could get the budget support to be able to go and do that. So you can have students coming from Belgium, from France, from all sorts of different countries, and being able to exchange. In Denmark, they will pay you 500 euro a week to be able to study. It's amazing. So when you look on the horizon for the deaf community, what do we see? What we see is that historically, the deaf community haven't had much access to academia. And it's something that they greatly need, but things are improving. We see on the European level, we see on the national level, on the regional level as well. Now we want to promote more deaf students and empower them to have access to higher education. And more and more deaf people now are moving into an academic environment. So because of that, the natural option is that there is more research into sign language. There's more research into what's happening with the deaf community, with deaf education. And from those findings, we can see how to implement and improve the educational settings for deaf people. There's more research into culture and linguistics. And all of this research, we're able then to present to the government and to show them pure scientific findings that can help to implement policy change. Now let me jump to a new topic. Do you recognise him? Yes. It was Ashley who's just been speaking with me before. Ashley and I are part of the European Deaf Academy. We went to Bulgaria. We had a fantastic time learning about leadership skills. And the European Deaf Youth have different representatives from around the EU. And Ashley and I are the UK representatives. This was Sign Circle, which the BDO Youth had an international sign workshop, and it was so popular with people who came that the tent was absolutely full. We had a great time. The BDO Youth focuses on 18 to 30, but we're not too pedantic about that. We're flexible to say that, you know, in different countries, they have camps for young children and older children. This was an American group. It's fantastic to see that one of our board members were there with that. When they came back to England, there was contact that was sent. And they wanted to contact the camp and say thank you. And they went home to their family and contacted us and said, I've gained so much of my own self-confidence and my self-worth. I feel a much better person. And thanks to BDA Youth and the youth organisations and the movement that's helping people to gain their own self-confidence. This was the VV competition that we had in Wolverhampton. I think there were some people who were in the final that are in the room here. But this was, and the same room where we have the Hal Draper tribute evening. There will be a finalist that you'll be able to see from London from Bristol who will give you a demonstration. So let me move on to the video youth. Before 2014, can we just hold a second, please, to allow some more people to come in? Yes, let's just allow some latecomers. We'll find these people and they'll have to pay into a bucket before they come from the room. Ah, the president of the organisation I was speaking to before. Before, so we can speak about that.
Anna, somebody just said that I find it difficult to see the Twitter on the blue background.
someone asked us to change it to blue because I didn't want red, so I didn't mind. I mean, what different people?
Okay, can we have attention before I continue? Everybody okay? Do you want to join me? Yes, you? Yes, come on. Would you like to see your hands? Yes, and you?
When the speech finishes.
Good. Right. It means that black whole time, well, that's one of the international Twitter events
black,
that's happening.
Black yeah. on white background or black text on, I don't know,
a black community. Why do you have the panel and the questions on? There are not going to be any of those subjects then. Let me tell you one thing that we can do. In 2014, they were also leaders, but in the sense of their own projects and self-determining what they did, they weren't able to handle it. But since 2014, there's been a big change, because the deaf youth were not noticed in the past. They were not present on a national level in the sense, but now the youth are much more prevalent, and the deaf youth is building a much stronger reputation. Since 2014, there's been four very successful projects. Front Runners is the first one. Front Runners was a leadership project from Devon. Now, they contacted us and they said that they were going to do one of their days in the United Kingdom and give a seminar. So, we as the BDO youth. So when should we have that? We had an international event, so we had it straight, we dubbed it into the international festival. Now the VV family should be in London, Bristol and Wolverhampton. And the winter ball just happened next week, just in West London and Brentford. There's a European Deaf Youth Camp that's coming as well. And that's going to be a Brighton Beach day out. And the Deaf Free Camp of Royal DFCE is having an international event there. So we're dovetailing with the BDA youth at the same time. So we'll have some British contingency, we'll have an international contingency. Hopefully the weather will be good, but it won't dampen our spirits and we'll have lots of great fun. We've changed our size since 2014. So there are plenty of events on the calendar. Lots of things, but I can't tell you about each of them that are going to come up in 2015 because we're all approved on the board first of all. If you become members of the BDA Facebook Twitter, you'll be kept up to date with all the events that are taking place. Let me tell you on a local level and a central government level and on a European, pan-European level as well. There are budgets on each of those, and there are budgets which specifically focus on youth. And they fund it so young people can come together and meet in different events. So we have strong connections with the people because we know that we need to have more representations and more people involved in events. So we've got the leadership program, we've got lots of different training opportunities. And I'm a funding officer for the BDA Youth, so I'm responsible for making sure that we're able to give lots of opportunities for young people. And really, this is a great climate for being able to realise the potential of deaf youth, because the funding opportunities are right there. Also, what we want to look at in the future is, it's very much been a London-centric events that are taking place. And we appreciate that we need to go out to the regions and we need to touch base with people in all four corners of the United Kingdom. Wherever they are, we need to try and empower and motivate young deaf people Moradin Letterkenny, because it's often said they're all in London, all the events. It's very expensive for them to travel there. So instead of them coming to London, we want the BTA youth to go out there and to improve the quality of life of the deaf people where they live. What do we want to the deaf youth movement? It's not on a regional level, but on an international level. People feel that the deaf world is shrinking. And the factors for shrinking are different theories that people can give. There are less sign language users. Social media means that people feel that the world is a lot smaller. Traveling much more, as air travel is so much cheaper, it's accessible to more people. So globalization means that although the deaf community is shrinking, people feel more connected around the globe. Past, there will be few international events, few deaf people go. It would be hard to all understand what Richard would have said many years ago. But now, deaf people think nothing of travelling across borders and find communication very efficient and very effortlessly. They're able to communicate with each other. So there's lots of youth organisations that are meeting, 50. There are lots of youth organisations that are meeting now on an international platform. So the EUDI I've spoken about, the WFDYS is the carbon holder of those organisations, the European Union of Deaf Youth and the World Federation of Deaf Youth. And plus there's the BDA Youth, and then there's all the national host countries youth organisations. So there's lots of international opportunities for deaf people to travel across the borders and to meet up. The future very much leans towards a more global relationship in the deaf community. But globalisation is part of threats. Globalisation is something that has happened since caveman times. As soon as I thought, is it possible that we aren't the only tribe, that across this land, from wherever I am, could there be other people? Now we know that from that time to now, people have travelled, people have spread, and we're not going to curtail globalisation. We're not going to stop it spread. There are pros and cons to globalisation, we all know that. But one of the pros for the deaf community is that it's a great advantage to have international legislation on a national level. For example, the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. Has anybody heard of this convention? Anybody heard of it before? Not good enough. Not good enough. I need all of you to be aware of this. Because I think in England, all deaf people should know about this, and that's why I think it's so important. The UN Convention has lots of really important advantages for the deaf community. And I think that in the future, that convention, because it's there, is something that we have to go and revise again and again and again. It won't stay in its present form. Now I'm not going to say that this convention is the panacea for the deaf community for all time. We are responsible to defend what we have now on the statute books, because otherwise they will drop these things off the convention. And the hard fight we've had to put on there, we don't want to lose those rights. So what are they? Article 9, accessibility. Article 21, freedom and access. Article 24, Article 30, participation. Sign language is mentioned 6 times. Deaf culture is mentioned. So this means that you people say, oh, there's no real value of deaf culture, but we've got it enshrined in European law. The deaf community is mentioned. When people try to dismiss us, we can use the convention. And not just deaf people, but deaf people are also mentioned. So guys, do your homework. I told you about the references of the articles, but that's not it. You're to go home, and I want you to look at it and make your own judgment on whether you think it's good or bad. Take a look at it. Just Google the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. That's what I want you to Google. Research it. It is fundamentally important for us as deaf people. The United Kingdom has signed this convention. And what this means, it means that we would read at the theater. And it means then that we can mount all rules in the United Kingdom to the UN Convention, but that hasn't happened in the United Kingdom yet. In Finland, they've started to look at what they have to do. They have to go through the laws with a fine tooth comb before they could sign it into UK law. Now, the UK won't do that yet, but we've got to make central government do this because they've got a legal responsibility to follow the UN Convention. So we need them to look at the laws we have in the United Kingdom and sign it and adopt it in the United Kingdom. There are threats to our future. And let me tell you what some of those are. One of the threats is that internationalisation. Some of my friends have said, you know, why don't all deaf people just use one sign language? And then you wouldn't have to have all different sign languages. And that would be an awful premise, because the national language of a country is part of the heritage and culture. And I think the reason they think that is because I think they don't feel that ESL is something that's worth holding on to. I think they feel things like ASL is better and stronger. But we need to tell them that ESL is very strong because it acts as a transit through our culture. It's sad to say that, you know, people talk about preserving ESL and trying to keep ESL. I don't think it's about preservation. I think it's about organic growth. You know, Shakespeare, the way Shakespeare was writing, is not how people write now. The language is organic, it moves, it lives and it changes. And I think that's the strength. The strength of ESL is it's beautiful and it grows and it changes. You know, all the finance that's sent to try and cure deaf people, genetics, and all these operations, 3D printing of new inner ears. You know, they could be looking at all these operations that they want to do. We might not like the thought of this, but you know, these are things that could be threats and they're things that we need to face up to. And as I say, we need to have a bigger focus on strengthening DSL. And I say that because we know we strengthen DSL. We know that we can be very comfortable using the language ourselves. But with hearing people, the government, you know, we need to make sure that they look at protecting ESL. It's a living language that we use. We need to show them that this is how we live. We don't live using hearing aids and looking at cures for our hearing. We use our language to be to live. Hearing aids and implants and the technology of the Chinese is not one of the threats, but I think the future threat to the deaf people. I hope it will happen one day. I'd like to see this before I die. You know, instead of going on the road to see any cars, before you cross over the road, there'll be hot cars. People will just, deaf people, you know, they don't know what they're doing. And they'll just be hover cars. So I think the government has always funded what we need to make sure that we can fund ourselves. And we need superpower armor so that whatever government is, we are able to stand strong and to continue. Thank you.
Just before I start, I'm just checking if we've got anybody who are able to come from the room. I'd like to say thank you to Thomas McQuinney for his amazing presentation. I'm sure you'll all agree with me that it was worth the early morning wake up to listen to Thomas share with us his experience of European culture. I've known Thomas since he was a little boy, and it's amazing to see him on stage now. I just feel so amazing. It is heartfelt to say thank you very much for a fantastic presentation. I do think people will agree with me that the BDA Youth is now coming to work with deaf people, you know, the older generation. And I think together as one, we have a more profound value. So thank you, Thomas, for your presentation. I wonder whether we need to introduce the rest of the board of the Youth Committee. Can I ask you to come forward? Down over the auditorium, so just to make your way down. So this is us. We are the Youth Committee. We have somebody else that unfortunately couldn't be with us today. They're actually revising for university. So we obviously give their apologies. I'm the chair, and then my name is Thomas, as I say. I'm the responsible for the finances and the treasurer. I am the project leader. And my name's Deidre, I'm the secretary. Just to add, as Thomas has mentioned, the relationship that we have with our European friends, if you like, and thinking about those international connections, there was a visit to Gallaudet University, and you know, we had a representation visiting that event. I wonder whether we need to have a quick photograph of us all together. As I say, Leila couldn't make it this morning. She's got commitments. Just to add, we have the evening programme in memory of Hal Draper. And we've organised the event this evening in collaboration with the BDA Northwest Deaf Association. So we'd just like to say thank you. support for the CNP's event. Okay, our second keynote is from Lady Port Sue Barry, who's flown in from, and I'd like to say welcome to Sue and thank her for her presentation. She'll be sharing with us the Deaf Youth Tribe project. Without further ado, I'll hand over to Sue. No, I'm not going to copy the cop. I'm going to copy Thomas. Thank you.
there. Hi, everybody. Good morning. Okay, I think that just means my presentation will be shorter and shorter.
I have the one. She's
okay.
So lovely.
Good morning. Rosemary had mentioned that Manchester is infamous for the rain, but today I was going to be mindful because the Northern Ireland is in Belfast and it's been torrential rain this past few days. We have come over from Belfast and good weather and weather, so I apologise for that, Manchester. It was a real honour to be invited to talk about my project here in the AGM called Deaf, Roots and Pride. It's very nice, Roots because, well, a lot of deaf people have failed, they've lost their identity, they've lost sign language, they've lost their culture. So through our project, we are giving them opportunities and skills. They'll end their immerse themselves into deaf culture. So the reason why we signed Deaf, Roots and Pride like this is because of the opportunities we're giving. A little bit of background about our project. We in Northern Ireland offer advocacy services and political campaign services. You know, there's a lot of cultural events, social events, which are all focused around the adult community. Now, I want to remind other organisations, deaf organisations, who are just focusing on being in Northern Ireland. We've found a group of that missing for our young deaf community members. We did a bit of research and then applied for funding for our project. The issues that we realised through our research that were affecting the deaf community were a lot of them were feeling isolated. So I'm sure everybody's aware, 95% of young deaf people were born into hearing families, which means they're mainstream in education and social events in the community. So everybody's already aware of this. And a lot of them are underachieving school on top of the way they mentioned. The young deaf people, I mentioned that there was 300 young deaf people in university, the Department of Education in London have mentioned that 70% of young deaf people in colleges and universities were underachieving, and that's consistent. So there's a lot more research needed in this area. In this room, I see that deaf people haven't had the opportunity to meet positive role models or deaf peers. Their emotional well-being is suffering as well, which is why one of the elements of our project is that. We've been funded by the daughter, and it's in the young deaf people aged 8 to 20. And through this presentation, I will just mention young people, which is covering children and young people, which is important. We keep this accent in children, young people, children, young people. So when I say young people, it covers that age range. The four elements to the project, the first is mentoring, and transitions, and culture. I would say the child, then the power of the time. The team is made up of the project coordinator, which is myself, I'm a full-time. The project administrator, which is from the members of the Cats Party, which you focus on the public for the mentor, the project mentor, and the transition officer, and that's my team. This is a map of Northern Ireland. I'm sure people don't know, but it's just a really quick map to show you the geographical area that we cover. Belfast is a bit more at the moment. So, Belfast to Oban, which is in County Tyrone, is roughly a 2-hour drive. It's just to give you an idea of the geographical area. Belfast up to Derry, and it's roughly 1.5 hour drive. I'm starting the first time with mentoring. It's given our young people an opportunity to make role models through the mentoring. It's also given them the opportunity to understand how the deaf people cope and deal with the barriers in everyday life. And it's also an opportunity for them to understand and accept their own identity.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
All our mentors are deaf. Today we have recruited 13 mentors in total. They've been through a rigorous recruitment process. They've had a one-to-one interview, a group interview, and the group interview covered diversity. And diversity is to cover religion, sexual orientation, communities. And basically, it was to assist them. And people completed their watch mentees that they matched up with. So, they've also completed 6 days of mandatory training. If they missed 1 day of training, they wouldn't have been accepted into the training. This is our group of mentors, and they come from all over North Ireland. They come from various backgrounds. Northern Ireland is from Ireland, but it does have two languages, and we have British Sign Language and Irish Sign Language. Our team of mentors
have lots of English. The patient can help you. I don't know.
So far, we have 19 mentees.
Definitely right.
A few weeks ago, we had 7 on our mailing list. But so our new cohort of mentors who have been able to get those matched up, and we have 2 mailing lists now. Well, we've had a lot of opportunity to find our mentees. But we feel the first year was the hardest. The second year, we sort of catching up really on our targets. We're planning to recruit a full cohort of mentors in January 15 because the demand is slowly increasing. In December, we are planning our first mentor, mentee, and parents get together. It will be the first time that they all met up because what we have realised is the parents feel quite isolated also. They feel as though they're the only parents that can have having issues with having a deaf child in the family, so it would be good to get them together for additional support. In May of 2015, we're hoping to get a residential, which is really exciting. We're looking forward to. We want to second down the transitions. Transition means change. And the change that our young people can be from their young person moving from school to secondary school. We all move from school. It's a small safe building with the same teacher, the same room, same friends. Moving into secondary school is a massive transition. Teachers, classrooms, and new friends. Transition can also be from the secondary school moving to college or university, into another institute, or moving into the workplace, moving to travel, moving into college replacement. Apart from educational transitions, it should also be a transition. And learn from their stories of experience when they exactly see the transition. So, young person can be certainly the new person going through this, and they can learn from mistakes or success stories from the deaf peers. We will also equip them with the skills and coping strategies to go through this period of life. It's also to reassure that young person that they're not in there by themselves, that there's a lot of support, there's other organizations out there.
Okay.
We have a few events coming up for transition. The first one's called Outside the Box. Thomas had also mentioned in his presentation that there's fewer young people in university. It's a big change of what they're doing there. Some young people have gone to college and realize that there was support there, that they needed. I can't really get a lot of time, whether it's a nerve tumor, a temporary, a nerve system. So this event outside the box is it. Most potential neural circuits available. You can make temples, try to learn, make temples, etc. This will be planned before the dual start of college in September, meaning when the removal is less complete than exactly what support that you request. But I think it will be interesting to see how this runs and save the number of admissions of technology and emotional weaknesses. So we have three events coming up, and three of those events coming up. The next one is Romance. We have 20 young mentees, aged around the 18 to 20 mark. They haven't attended school in this kind of years.
Okay.
That's two of our mentees, and that's two of our 19. So they have stayed in the home. They wanted to go to college, but it was a massive culture shock. They had been in school for 5 years, and we were in education establishment in 2007. They didn't know where they could be. So we thought, so a group of young people like that was to go back to basics to prepare them for college life. So that was the team in 1990s that we had, which was a lot of young people in the
university.
The third event is to boost your future. You're in charge of the school, so you have lots of opportunities to do your respect, which is fine. But for deaf young people, you really thought that you would have a career respect with deaf people who are not deaf. That's not deaf. It's what you do with deaf issues. And I think that the young deaf people, the inspiration to think, you know, I'm not deaf, but I'm not deaf. It should open your mind to the...
You don't have to do that, do you? Probably the ground time, but the screen will come.
And that would get to the end of 16.
The new ground.
That's the transition zone.
With the fruit, fruiter.
The new. You can do the third island sign, which do. Yeah. Through the information itself, which can help you get them, but lots of areas, which are definitely there for them, comes up from the different than they want to. We engage with all organizations and other organizations in the movement. And I think just quickly, just talk about a couple of examples of the same person. We have teenagers, and they're home on local scale. When she's asked what they want to achieve, they have not. So three relations refer to mentoring, and through the mentoring process, there's another deaf organization here in Hackathon. If you're any of the mentoring aspect to the mentoring process, it doesn't mean that. Mentoring had encouraged them, explain to the advantages and benefits of getting involved in this deaf event. Then they travel, they food, and they find themselves not involved in that event. And amazing time. It really was an eye-opener for her. You know, and realized that it was more like a time in the moment. And it's not that far away. There's a lot of friends over there. And then to have this time with my friends, I would be my friends on Facebook. They were able to realize what skills and potential they had. They had no idea if they want to work with them. And this speaks to 2 weeks of going to that event with a massive life change. So,
The second example was a referral to a volunteer organisation. As I mentioned earlier, the women Bushmen have missed school from the age. They've been stuck in the waiting room for a very tight time. A lot of anger issues. So through the mentoring, they were referred to a counselling organisation. We do have a counselling. And again, through the counselling staff, they have realised that the things that I'm proud of and open down the organisation. That's basically what our project is here, to give solutions, to give opportunities to our young people. Moving on to the last but not least, the culture end. The cultural element is basically the heart of our project. We believe it's okay for the institution. But young people need to go through the mentoring, they need to go through the training, they need to go through the transition. Basically, deaf events, meeting other deaf people, being exposed to the deaf community, the deaf peers, and that's what helps them realize we do have the control. It's a much better thing on the side, which is really good. That's our incredible culture. And I'm delighted to say, I'm actually talking about the CST, because I think our project is very familiar. So maybe not the political side, because we need to do further research and evidence and statistics for that. Then we can approach them and say that, you know, the PR and I'm not going to come back to you and say that's very good. These are examples of cultural events that we have had on the meetings. We have the cultural event. We have one meeting. He was very passive. He didn't really get involved in the stand up. He got involved in the drama on the cultural event on the star of the show. We've had two young people. We have tour guides for the definition of BSL and RSL. Just thought that was absolutely amazing. And we had Ashley come over and talk about BDA youth and EUDY. And then that day, I think it really worked the ice because we have worked well with Northern Ireland Deaf Youth Association, but I think Ashley came over with just them not being able to do the job straight away. And it definitely was. I think we just welded Lydia and ourselves together. It was fabulous. And from then, we have had the first back and forth from the Northern Deaf Youth Association. We're really looking forward to working in partnership with them in the future. So that's where we had. We had International Women's Day, which is basically the day that we invite all women, all deaf women, to come and talk about the scriptures. That's just a few photographs from some of our events. See that man at the front? Anybody recognize him? That's Jerry Hughes. And it's the first day of man was talking about the world. So he was an amazing person to come and talk about the international event. But as I say, the project has been rolling out for 18 months. And I was happy to be invited because it gave me time to look back on what challenges we've been across. And for that area, I was actually trying to establish people who didn't think that people were. As a people for media and pastor. And also, when we met the young deaf person, and they could meet some of the community or some of the enterprise with them or have the issues we are. Likewise with the parents. As I said, it was like a dark community going to the community. And talk about the oral educational approach. We have had a lot of difficulties where you are interested in the scientific technical. That's kind of like a issue with the answer.
as I said, what I fix on your people to get to 20. We look them up there.
From screen.
I think we could actually start from both. And again, funding for the sustainability of the project has been a challenge. So we have put on there to start with 1,500 as a project goes. But for this first things will keep going. And just talking about the challenges. You had mentioned about the 2 million people who haven't been in school for 5 years. I thought what was very interesting about that was the education board didn't even go to parents. They didn't go to referendum support. They didn't go to the IA. They didn't go to the school. And I'm just wondering, how's that feeling? You can actually be in this school for 5 years. Would they go to the same? I think they would go to a very different thing. They would have to go to the community parents. And as I previously mentioned, being a big family of ones, I think that's really one of the best in family. Of the 1918 to the present, 7 of 4 their families and the pictures were in sign language. The families were to in sign language. And I was like, oh yeah, we're going to go to college, etc. And yeah, we're going to go to college. We're going to go to college. We're going to go to college with their siblings, with the grandparents. They wanted to be in the school course for them. We have been coming to sign language. Of course, there's 3 families, but they're not going to be there. So if families are in the middle of the sign language, and it's just a really short story I really like to share with you, which is we were visiting for an event, and it was a bit of a just sat chatting. And she just had the commission to the interview. My child was 4. I thought it was very good. We were never allowed to group the sign languages, but she came over and she just said, I'm sorry for interrupting. And she gets to know her son going 4. He was really no problem. And she saw the work of her project and looked so excited. And then she was absolutely better. She realized that her project started, which is good. Her son was only 4. So, while I was chatting to her, one of the mentors was working on sign. I was talking sign word to my child, and he says, yeah. So excited. I saw it. And my mother was like, the first she had seen was I sparkle and smile. And that's when I realized that you could then make communication in your own language. And hopefully that she produces a lot of frustration for the organization, the earlier the intervention is. And again, that led on to the study of the family centers in. I know that my mother was so we've gone through the challenges, we've gone through the gaps, but not all the successes. And we do have a lot of successes from the project. I remember our very first day on the project. We went to the office and we had a desk. That was it, just a desk. We had a desk. The induction lab and our tablets. Okay, that was it. It was no PC. No laptop, nothing. 18 months later, I can say we're really as a team of achievement. I'm just very proud of work. The lab in Rome is still posting an elementary training. The week we were in scratch, we delivered the team. We look back, we're actually very, very committed to what we've achieved. We're also very proud of all our mentors. They're all deaf and we're not volunteers, we're paying them to staff, so we've been able to provide job opportunities for 13 million people. Their skills have improved, their knowledge has improved, their patience. because it's also very ideal where you can spin strength over the world and the places that you're perfect. So just one side of the support from us. And that's why I think our devil to help us to do is most important factor of the world. And for Nick herself, well, yes, the success I consider is a change in life. I just want to do this. As soon as I say I'm changing my life, that's it. I'm going to balance my life with this success to do it. We have been officially recognized and understand that there's a level of the management of the foundation and we have built us with a good foundation. So it's the management of the foundation. What are they based? Is anybody who really actually based? Not for this. They're based in Manchester. Yeah, they're based in Manchester, and Manchester does not tie up perfectly with the New Zealand. So I just wanted to go to them at the edge. And I only found out officially on the website that we received the benchmark. And I've been holding it until now, so I've been at 100. Normally, I'm trying to find the foundation here based in Manchester. So I think maybe I'm looking at it and just go to explain it.
So, the Mentoring and Befriending Foundation provides support to organisations who run mentoring and befriending projects, and we do that through providing resources, toolkits, training, and we also have a membership network as well as the quality standard, the approved provider standard. So if you want to find out more, please go on our website and you can do that at your leisure. So the reason I'm here today, as explained, is that the British Deaf Association of Northern Ireland applied for our quality standard and went through the process. And the quality standard has 10 requirements or benchmarks to which the project has to reach. And then when they feel that they are there, that they reach our 10 requirements, then we go and do an assessment on the project. So I went out fast on another very wet and windy day back in October. And carried out the assessments, and had a really enjoyable time. And for myself personally, it was a real education finding out about some of the issues that young deaf people face, and also about how it can be tackled as well, how people can be empowered to overcome some of those issues and barriers. And carrying out the assessment, I spoke to the staff, the project staff, the mentors, I spoke to parents of the young deaf people, and I also received some questionnaires that the young deaf people had completed. The things that really struck me, I suppose, on the day were the identification of the need for the project was very clearly done, and the ideas on how the issues that were identified could be tackled were very, very well thought out and clearly done as well. And also, most definitely, just speaking to the mentors and the staff, it was the passion and the enthusiasm for how they went about their work and how they wanted to, help create change in Northern Ireland for young deaf people. And then from speaking also to the parents as well, hearing about how very quickly great change was coming about in the lives of the young people through having this mentoring intervention and how they were becoming empowered and just being able to, I suppose, access and express themselves and access services much more effectively through having this support was very clear to me and really struck me. So I think I am going to, I think, present the certificate in this envelope. It's not the new iPad. It's simply much better. So this is the certificate for the Deaf Roots and Pride project achieving our approved provider quality standard and meeting the 10 requirements of APS. And now they have that accreditation for 3 years now, as and they are an approved provider standard project with the Prudential and the Friendly Foundation. So congratulations. Thank you. That was all yours.
I would just like to add that I think for me, it's amazing. It's amazing to see that from an 18-month dead stop start, in 18 months, what they were able to achieve is unbelievable. And it's a recognition of Sue and her team's efforts and how fantastic they've been. Because it's so positive that when children don't know their identity and find their identity, it's such a transformation. And to see that empowerment and that confidence they have, it's amazing. And for parents to see this certificate does mean a lot. It might not mean a lot to some people, but for parents, it gives them the reassurance. So a huge thanks to Sue and the team. And also, may I say, I think it's important to say a huge thanks to the MBF. Are you from Manchester? Are you a Manchester boy?
I live in Manchester, yes.
That's not answering my question. Anyway, that's a politician's answer. But it's really important. It's really important that a professional body like yours recognises the good work that the DRP have done. It's not just a piece of paper. It's actual a professional award. Thank you. Well done to everybody. Thanks so much.
Again, I'd like to say thank you to Sue for her presentation. I think the whole morning has been so energising and so positive that we're really grateful for your presentation. I would hope to see this project being replicated in other areas. I mean, it was awful to hear of the lady with this deaf son who was 4-year-old who really was struggling, and I think it's important to think about the work that this project is doing and the support that they're providing, but also recognition of the benchmark achievement. It is vital. Hopefully this project can run from birth to, as you say, 25 years. So thank you again, Sue. It was nice to listen to that metaphor of the ripple effect of skimming stones. I think we could all skim a stone today and we would have a big ripple effect. Even some may prefer to skim a rock and see how that affects the deaf community. So can I ask the morning presentation, the speakers from the presentation this morning, to come up to the panel so we can open the floor for questions. Okay, if anybody does have a question, if you could raise your hand to indicate you would like to ask a question. We also will be taking questions from Twitter, and I'm not a Twitter expert, so we'll probably have to bear with us this morning. I'm just wondering if you want the slides to be turned off. just to adjust this into the place. Okay, just while we're waiting, if I can ask you to form a queue to the left-hand side of the stage for those that do want to ask a question. And if you are using sign language, if you can stand where I'm standing to present your question for the photographer to see the question. Okay, so if you can ask me to ask a question on the stage here, thank you.
Hi everybody, hello. My name is Kathy. I'm from Liverpool. This is my sign name. Hello everybody. I have a question. I want to ask Sue from Northern Ireland. In England, there can be a fine from the school. Does Northern Ireland have fines that they have? Because, you know, if the children have been missing and not being able to go to school, has there not been fines? You said the children have missed school, they haven't been to school, it's been 5 years or so. Has there not been, you know, has it not been picked up by the local authorities who are meant to produce these fines for being absent from school?
Okay, as I mentioned, they've missed school for 5 years and more than 5 years in some circumstances. Okay, no, I think maybe, yeah, you control me. You tell me where I'm supposed to stand. Well, it's interesting that you mentioned that because the parents that I have met were very frustrated because they felt they had actually approached the school, the education board. They had been approaching the education board themselves, and the education board basically just didn't want to help them. There were no fines, nothing like that.
I don't understand why they weren't fined, because if they were here, they would have been.
Yeah, definitely a fine didn't happen. Well, yeah, I would agree with you that you'd think that they would be treated similarly, but through the research that we have completed, I have been working with the Deaf Students Union, and I plan to work with that and we could do joint research puts on that and we'll be working on it. But I'm sorry that I can't give you more of an answer, but that's the evidence we have come up with, being more fans.
Hello everybody, good morning. Good morning. Just a second. Is this where you wish me to stand? Yeah? Is this okay here? My name is David Jackson. I'm from Bristol. I'm actually originally from London, but I moved to Bristol. I said, but okay, Bristol, I sound Bristol like this, okay? I'll do Bristol like this because it's so important that I do Bristol like this. Let me remind everybody, because people are like, from Bristol or not from Bristol, there's this side of Bristol and that side of Bristol. Are you happy with Bristol? Just to confirm, I wouldn't like you to be unhappy. Okay, I've got two questions I'd like to ask. One of them is, that's a difficult question. I've forgotten your name, apologies. One's for Sue. My other one is a technical question for Thomas. I'm sorry, I'm not great with names. My first question to Sue. My wife Eva My wife wanted to know where you got that project funding from. Where did they get the project funding from? That's what we wanted to know. He was saying the question wasn't false. Sue clearly said where her funding was from. Apologies, I thought you wanted me to ask Sue. No, it's the other two. Where did you get your funding from? When we apply for funding, we apply for individual projects. So supposing I was doing a filming project, then there's the filming council. If it was to do with something else, it could be the Department of Work and Pensions. There are different governmental arms and different budgets. Now, there are 200 bodies that you can contact, and you basically go to the ones that best represent the project. And if you're doing it the first time, you continue on, because, you know, there are so many different places where one can gain funding from.
And can I just add to that, actually, talking about the BDMUs, so far we've done a range of projects, and I should say a very big thank you to the British Deaf Association for giving us that budget to be able to expand what we're doing. They gave us a budget over and beyond what we thought we'd get. We've been able to set up really exciting projects that have really supported what it is that we want to do and achieve. Because we've had that, it means that we are able to apply for more funding. So actually,
My second question is more technical for Thomas. You're talking about the future and the dangers of the future. One temporary concern that I have is a lot of the IT companies, the blue chip companies, they're all needing to focus equipment to look at new or backup. And some people are being left out of technology devices that are about speech. They're all about human speech.
And that's true, but that's only one strand of technology. There are always various strands to technology. Now, you're right in saying there may well be some areas of technology that are focusing on the year, but there are other aspects of technology that are really popularizing that people choose like FaceTime, Skype, video conferencing. Now, this is really great. So yes, there are some people and some areas of technology that are doing things in different ways. Now, there might be things where we see technology in the future linked with voice recognition services and sign recognition services, but no one is what it could be.
Hi, my name is Penny, and this is my sign name, and it's linking into the old Penny that we used to have. I'm from South East London. However, my grandfather and my father's side of the family are actually from Manchester. I've got four different comments, really. Firstly, I'd like to focus my first question and comment around the deaf youth education. Really applaud that initiative. It's been a great opportunity for us, and I think, you know, people that are entering sort of postgraduate qualifications, you know, regardless of age, is really important for deaf individuals. And there's a lot of older deaf people at older university. I'm wondering whether they can access your organisation.
The two movements that I mentioned is the Deaf Youth Movement and there's the Deaf Student Movement. And that's the reason why there is a distinction. The Deaf Student Movement has no age criteria at all. The Student Union started under the European Deaf Youth. Actually, what we thought was that the Deaf Youth was 18 to 30. And we said, well, look, so we had a student who was over 30 on a postgrad course, could they be in? He said, no, they just have to go to the BBD. So, what we do is thanks to the European Deaf Youth Group, the PDA Youth is able to look at setting up an independent organisation that is separate from it. So now we have the European Deaf Youth Group, and that can work with the older students, but the student union movement what's important is that people are able to access higher academia, PhDs, postgraduates. Yes, there's a lot of resource information. Yeah. And there's alumni as well who come to universities and who have experiences. So we follow the same philosophy that we're all able to share regardless of it.
Thanks. I think it's important that we think about the whole financial implications of that. Secondly, I'd like to think about the technical sensitivity of research.
Diversifying with different member groups.
I know we have representatives here today from different groups. And some of those groups aren't necessarily going to be conflicts in our group on stage. Now, the point for us is to be able to extend our reach. I'm not going to talk on their behalf. They can talk for themselves, but for sure, it's about supporting people and giving them the confidence to work with us.
Hi, my name's Zoe. I really would like to thank the presentations that the presenters this morning. I think we've all felt quite touched by the presentations. First thing we'd like to ask Sue Barry, in terms of your project, do you know whether there's something similar in the UK? Really at the moment, do you know? So that was my first question, whether there's a similar project within the UK. Secondly, I'd like to think really around the role model itself and how that is paid or remunerated to the mentors. Yeah,
see
what can I answer
the
second question first?
The problem that I have to think about it. Where did you?
Okay, so I've been asked if my mentor is a voluntary or worker, they're paid them to start from a 0 hour contract and they get paid for the time spent with the mentee. We also pay travel expenses and activities, whatever it is the mentee and mentor during the day. That's what we pay those expenses. And that's when I had said that would improve that young deaf person is in the mentor's future employment opportunities.
Thank you.
I'm not going to talk for too long because actually I'm actually talking about a lot of this afternoon. So I will hold some of that for the afternoon. But I do want to say that we are completely committed to this project, the Deaf Reach and Pride project. It is a fantastic project. We have seen so many benefits from it in such a short period of time. We are looking to release some of the restricted funds that we've had within the organisation for some time now to be able to instill this project in three different regions, but I will explain the detail of that this afternoon.
I'm Mark Heaton. Mark, I'm from close to Preston in the Northwest. Congratulations to the three of you. Very exciting presentations. Sue, first of all, Sue's talking about her project. I'm not going to ask her. You're halfway through the 3-year project. When it reaches its conclusion, will you be able to publish your findings? Will you be able to publish a report so that I can take it to places like Lancashire City Council and Lancashire County Council? Because at the moment, Lancashire County Council, well, gosh, it's a mess. They've made a lot of redundancies of the staff, and it's had a real effect on the services to deaf children and deaf youth in Lancashire. At the moment, Lancashire County Council have got this notion that they want to set up a well-being integrated service. So health, right across the social services, they'll all be integrated. There'll be no special services for deaf people. And we said, no, we don't want this. Now, your project could be something that I could use as a tool to show the council. So that's my, I've got two questions there. That's my first question. Will you publish your findings at the end of the 3-year project? Yes, will you publish a report?
At the moment, I'm gathering evidence for research and gathering the evidence to see what does work, what doesn't work, and what should be published in that. The 2 years of that is for future funding, because obviously we want the project to continue. And it's also to share with other organisations that we will hopefully be working in partnership with in BDA, because obviously BDA we set the project up, but we will be working in partnership with other organisations. So, part of the program covers what works, what doesn't work. And obviously, maybe we could come over and do a mentor training for yourself. Does that answer the question? Is that okay?
Thank you.
The question was asking about Northern Ireland, and really what's happening in the rest of the United Kingdom. The BTA board and senior management recognise the importance it's clearly shown of being able to have that pride in the roots. And we're looking at being able to look at funding potentials for the southwest of England. Yes, yes. Also, we will be planning for not only how we can get the funding, but a lot of the educational authorities have gone through huge change with central government's new educational act. So special needs education statement has been dealing with it. And it's made a huge change. And this integrated health and education social services policy. So they plan to make substantial change and they plan to give parents more control. If I give you an example, if a parent lives in the Surrey area, for example, and if a parent wants to know what the local authority is able to offer and looks at that and then checks what another local authority has, then they can use the other authority as a precedent to say, I want what they're offering in the next door county. So one potential for that is we can use it to push for more sign language in schools, but it will go through a lot of flux, a lot of change. And we started now recently, the BDA, to work with parents to grasp control back instead of having things foisted upon them.
Hello, my name is Maria Pollock, and I'm from two countries really. Brazil, It's really around the model, and I was interested about that. You may think that it's interesting coming from an older person, but my heart is very young. Thinking about the political side of the model, and again, this is where the heart lies, and how that will really be entrenched within the community, but thinking about that relationship with culture. You know, I also think that in terms of regions, there needs to be a re-energizing sort of focus. And I do feel that from Thomas and his presentation, it's very inspiring that when Thomas was guiding us through the UN Convention, it's important that we do think about this and the implications, but the only thing we do forget that it is present. And how we can use the UN Convention to influence campaigns within our own councils, our own areas. I wonder whether there's anything that we can take away, something tangible, so we can flag it up with our councils and back in our own areas to say, actually, you know, it is written in the law. It is really important that we do take this opportunity to speak to our
Well, I think that's a fantastic question. I think the first thing to reference there with the PCST model, that idea came about just in January of last year. We've subsequently had a range of conversations about our direction moving forward. But this PCST model is not something that we have invented as the BDA, and it's not something that we're instilling for ourselves only. This is something that we want to share amongst the entire community. I mean, we have been talking with the European Union for the Deaf Youth Movement. They have this model in place. It's what we're looking to put in place. The World Federation for the Deaf are putting this in place. We're actually the ones who are lagging behind, to be honest. So we're looking to catch up, we're looking to step into line. We want to see, and what we have been doing, is seeing what works and taking a model that has proven to work, instilling it ourselves, and we're well aware that at this point in time, we're only talking. We're telling you what we'd like to do. Now what we need to do is show you and show each other that it works. Now, your second question, I don't know if that was to myself or Thomas, to either of us. Well, I'll answer, and if Thomas wants to add, that's absolutely fine. Now, I think the BSL Charter is a really good, positive example to show what the BDA have been doing to work regionally. Now, this BSL Charter is for local authorities to sign up to make sure that they have that support to deaf people living within their regions. Now, we're going to have a fringe meeting after this panel session. During that fringe meeting, one of them will be talking about the BDA Charter. So if you have more interest in that and would like to know more details, we'll be talking about it then. But, you know, we will be having a report on the BSL Charter. And Terry will be discussing that in far more detail this afternoon as part of the annual general meeting. But this is a report that we've put together that combines all of the VSL Charter work that we've done and what we're doing with central government. But I better stop now, otherwise we'll have nothing left to discuss as part of the annual general meeting this afternoon.
Basically, to answer your question, we asked the BDA what the BSL GCSE was going to happen. Maybe the BDA could respond about what's happening with the GCSE. That's something that's a new thing that's been brought up. The panel are now asking new questions. I'm not sure if you agree, but right, okay, so the panel's asking new questions. Basically, Signature wants to have a new qualification on a GCSE standard. And the BSL support them in their aspirations, the BDA support them in that. It's important. People ask me why the BDA is supporting that. Well, I'm supporting that because the feedback we have from hearing people is that they don't finish the journey with the languages in school. And later on, they leave school, they forget. But what they find is that if they know BSL, then in work, in school, in college, meeting around the streets, anywhere, they could come into contact with people who are deaf, and they could do sign language work. And imagine if in a street, we just get out the car and start signing that. It's a living language that's used in Britain. French and German are used for adults. This is a British language in Britain, a living language, so I think we have to support it. This is the first step. Yes, thank you. Hello. My name is Greg. I live in Lord Warrington. Now, my profession is working for the UK's largest digital retailer. Also, I'm part of the BSL Forum. And I'm a rep for the Rob Warrington area. So, to all of you as a panel, the presentations were amazing. I really enjoyed all of them. I thought the presentations were amazing. For those of you who were talking about Europe, and about youth, and about students, and you were talking about the internationalization of deaf people for the younger generation, and you were talking about the student union doesn't have an age limit on. I don't know, what about people in work, in professional sectors? What about people over 30 years of age? What networks do we have in the UK and in Europe that they can latch on to? There's nothing there. Lots of professionals are working in isolation, and they may wish to share their experiences. And I think it's really important that we don't forget the professionals in work.
Well, I think firstly, that's a great question. There are loads of deaf organisations internationally. I think that's very important to state right from the start. Now with the NCVO, I think that's where we have the responsibilities to have that passed on into the local communities within that area. So I know we're going to be talking later about how we feed into the WFD and how it works in that way. Now, I understand that deaf people coming into professional life and looking for professional jobs, I completely understand what you're saying. Working in the UK's largest digital retailer, now I'm not quite sure where we would have a contact there with interpreting or what have you. I know with interpreters, we have contacts with Wesley. So there are international unions there for professionals that work within the deaf community. As myself, I'm here with the BDA Youth and I feed into WFD. I'm not quite sure how that would work with your individual profession.
Thank you for the information. I can take that away and do my own research. You were talking about BSL needing to be strengthened. And I agree with you, it does need to be strengthened. Because in the professional world, there's lots of jargon comes about. In BSL, we don't have the jargon as an equivalence. And we need to create that jargon. But I'm sure all of you in your own areas of work, you're using BSL. We're coming into contact with English words, and I think BSL will be strengthened by enriching the language that we use with new lexical items.
I couldn't agree more. I think BSL needs to be strengthened. It's a real organic language. I have debates with people almost daily about people that say it should be preserved, not strengthened, grown, evolved. You know, I think BSL is a language. If you think about it, there are three letters. It's British Sign Language. If you look at Auslan, that's slightly different. But anyway, I think it's important that we be clear. It is an organic language. It is alive. Now, I would like to talk to Ramon, credit Ramon Wolf, who's actually working here today. What's really very interesting is that deaf people don't have formal education of British Sign Language. So if you think of hearing children, of course, they are still taught English, regardless of English being their native language. They're taught the differences between verbs, adjectives, etc. Now, as deaf children, we don't have formalised teaching of British Sign Language. It remains as a native language, but not a taught language. Now, I look over to the States, and deaf children coming through in America at the age of 6 are talking about the lexical and linguistical differences in American Sign Language, not just using the language, they understand the language. And I would like to see the same implemented here.
Thank you. I've got one more. Is that okay? I've got one more question I'd like to answer. I recall the BDA set up the SLTA a long, long time. The SLTA a long, long time ago. And as Tom said, I've never been taught how my language works, what it is. I taught English language, and at Durham University, all that time back, what Denmark says, how many directional verbs do we know? I put my hand up and I said, there's 7. What? Really? 7 directional verbs. Okay. Passed a paper out and said, there's 100 directional verbs that we could put up on a flip chart in front of us. That was the first time I realised that we could start to look into our own sign language. And from the BSLTA, those people went out and spread the word to different places. Now, at Derby School, they have deaf children there. And Wendy Dorrance and Jerry Hanford, they're teaching the children from Lehigh about what sign language is and giving them a sign language BSL certificate. And saying, look, you do know it. So you're absolutely right. That's not enough. We need more of it. We need to be responsible to do that too. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. I've got one final question. As a BSL forum that wants an area, deaf children in my area, they don't know where they are. And I really assume it's difficult to go out there and find where the deaf children are. Now, in the professional part, there are ways where you can find people, you can network. We can contact people, and then they can tell another professional, and then we can show models of different professions, and children in school can say, gosh, that's something I'd like to do. And also, many children think they can't be in a certain profession, because they'll never have the skills, and it'd be lovely for deaf people to go in and show deaf children, look, I can do this job, you can do it.
Thank you for those interesting questions. Unfortunately, we've run out of time. I'm sure everybody will agree with you that we're dying for a coffee break. Just to share with you what we will expect this afternoon. Okay. And thank you to our panel members. the exhibitions are placed, I don't know whether you've been there already, but you come out of this room and turn left. There's a lot of exhibitors there, manned by their staff members. It may be that you want to ask questions to them or put yourself to some information. So please do use that time during the week to network and discuss with our exhibitors what the way is there. We then have a fringe meeting, and the fringe meetings will be focused on all the deaf people of the ESL Charter. And they'll be led by the NDA staff. We'll then, that will go on to 1:30. Lunch is available here. You can do your lunch in the bar area. They do have paper pens and to order your lunch in English. Well, there's the cafe area just as a premium on the right hand side. There's also different shops and cafes that are available on the main street to the left. And we would hope to see you back at 1:30 at the start of the AGM. Please do enjoy your break and have a good stretch of your legs. And I'll see you back for the French meeting around about 10 to 12. Thank you.
For sure. We'll break it. Perfect. Good, good. So as you know, I obviously take a drink and stuff because I've been standing up the entire time, and feel free to take a seat whenever you want. And as you know, I'm just going to try and into that.
So
this is what's not really clear to me, because there's a couple of optional stuff going on. Exactly, and then a bit of lunch. I think we can just be leaning out. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. You've been that one. Have a look, yeah. So, yeah. So I think you can mill around and check out what back here, and then officially it starts back here at 1:30. So I reckon, yeah. And you know what? Sometimes you go in a group, you know, okay? Done inside. So I just have to do a lot of animation. Yeah, I was going to say, feel free to go up and down and go as close as you want as well to get food. Yeah, and then on the crowd shots as well too. I'm very excited to be having a lunch on the spot. Yeah. Okay, cool. Thanks, Matt. Oh, yeah, and again, help yourself to eat, drink, and lunch.
People.
Yeah, exactly. not a liberal. I don't. Oh, I wish we had a liberal. I just have to go to the bathroom. Oh no, I'm not. I'm dipping upstairs. I wish there was someone that could tell me the last one. But we should yes. I'm gonna take out some money. I'm just gonna bring it back. We should both get some food for a drink. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure.